Okay.
Well, welcome to Our World Today, a progressive political show imagining a better tomorrow. Tonight, we're going to talk about an issue that is so important, and people just don't know about it, and we'll find out why. Our guest is Josh Wise. He's executive director of Minnesota Fair Trade Coalition. And thank you so much for coming on. I'm so glad to be talking about this tonight because it's so important, and people just don't know about it. But let's begin with your organization, the Minnesota Fair Trade Coalition.
Sure. Well, the Minnesota Fair Trade Coalition has been around since 1991. We were originally started to oppose the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA. And we're a coalition of about 70 organizations. We are primarily based in the labor movement. We work with environmental groups, we work with faith groups, consumer rights, and human rights nonprofits here in Minnesota to assess the impact of trade policy on Minnesotans and to advocate for maintaining our quality of life and spreading that quality of life around the globe.
My goodness. Thanks for being around and existing and doing what you're doing. And let's get in. And you told me before the show that you speak on TPP, the Trans-Pacific
Partnership.
You speak on this 50 times a year.
Yeah, close to it, yeah, if not more.
So we're not worried at all that you're going to have something to say.
Well, I hope not.
That's so bad. So tell us just basically what it is.
Sure. Well, ever since the early 90s, the United States has pursued this philosophy called free trade theory. Which says that if every country focuses on what it exports most efficiently, then the economic pie will grow.
Yes, this is the theory.
This is the theory.
Or the excuse or the...
Exactly, and of course, you know, it's predicated on two assumptions that are relatively flimsy in the real world. One is that both countries in the agreement are operating at full employment. So that if you are if you lose your job in a factory, you can immediately go find a job at the same wage,
yes.
Which,
isn't true.
Exactly. If you lose a job in a factory and you go to work in retail or you go to work on a farm, you're making a fraction of the wage that you were making doing a production job. And the other thing that it was predicated on was that capital was relatively mobile or immobile, you know, tied to the land. Your land were your assets, and all your capital was in your land. And then labor was mobile and could travel between the partners doing trade.
Oh,
and of course, now in the 21st century economy, we see exactly the opposite.
Yes, exactly.
Where big banks and big business can move their money wherever the labor is cheapest, wherever the environmental regulations are the lowest, or wherever the public health regulations are the lowest, et cetera. So the first big agreement under this, you know, free trade theory was NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement between the Canada, the United States, and Mexico. And what we've seen is that almost immediately after NAFTA passed, factories shut down in the United States, and they opened up right across the U.S.-Mexico border in these factories that are called maquiladoras, where, you know, workers were paid about a tenth of the wage that they were making in the United States.
Yeah. And meanwhile, we started closing the border at the very same minute.
Well, that's the interesting thing about it,
yeah.
Because our crisis of immigration was much smaller pre-NAFTA. People were still worried about it, of course.
Yes.
What happened was when NAFTA passed, the U.S. flooded the Mexican market with corn and other grain exports from our very, very large, often subsidized farms and of course, using the largest agribusiness companies in the world, like Cargill and Monsanto and ADM and
et cetera. All subsidized.
Exactly. Using them as the middlemen. And they basically sold the grain on the Mexican market at less than it actually cost to produce the grain in Mexico.
So there's or, no
I'm
way.
Sorry, less than it actually cost to produce the grain in the United States, but yes. because of the subsidies, they were still making a profit.
Yes.
And so the farms in Mexico, the average farm size before NAFTA was only 11 acres. And what happened was because of all these cheap grain imports, it displaced almost, well, over 2 million Mexican farm workers and farmers. And of course, you know, when you've been kicked off your land, you've lost your farm, and the only thing you've known your whole life is agriculture, you know, your choices are either go work in the maquiladora, where the factory conditions are not great, and give up your way of life, or come to the United States and do what you've always done, which is agriculture.
Right.
And so NAFTA has actually been the number one source of emigration from Mexico to the United States
yes.
in the last 20 years. So that's, you know, that's free trade theory in a nutshell. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is the latest iteration. So,
yes.
you know, after NAFTA, there was CAFTA, the Central American Free Trade Agreement.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just recently, we passed three free trade agreements with Colombia, Korea, and Panama. And those have had pretty disastrous consequences as well.
On everybody. On all the countries,
yeah,
economies, and all the people.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I mean, not only the workers, but just everybody. The only people that gain from these
are the big corporations.
Yeah.
You know, and that's one of the other fundamental problems with free trade theory.
Yeah, so it's really not free.
Exactly. What it does is it shifts the ability to manage the trade from the governments to the big corporations. So they're able to basically, one, deregulate, you know, any sort of public interest regulations like public health safety standards or environmental standards.
Right.
But two, they're enabled to act new regulations that favor them, such as
yes.
longer pharmaceutical patents, which threaten our access to affordable medicine.
Yes.
So, you know, it's a whole host of corporate giveaways. And now after NAFTA, we had CAFTA, we had the Korea, Panama, Colombia, et cetera. Now they're trying to pass this thing called the Trans-Pacific
Yes.
Partnership, which is 12 countries with borders on the Pacific Rim. It's the U.S., Canada, and Mexico, so the three NAFTA countries, and then Chile, Peru, Australia, New Zealand, Brunei, Singapore, Vietnam, Malaysia.
Wow.
And Japan.
Wow.
Yeah. And all told, it's 40% of the entire world's economy. But that's not all.
That's not all.
Yeah, right? It has what's called a docking agreement provision in it, meaning that other countries can join onto the agreements at any point in the negotiation, provided they agree to what's already been negotiated. So, because it's open to any country on the Pacific Rim, China could join, Argentina could join, Colombia
okay.
could join, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, actually, probably not Argentina. But any
why
country
not
with
Argentina?
A...
Argentina? Sorry.
Well, they don't have a border on the Pacific Ocean.
Oh, yes, that's true.
I got my geography wrong. I'm sorry.
Yes.
But anyway, any country with a border on the Pacific Ocean. But China's, you know, the real worry. But if all the eligible countries join, it would be over 60% of the entire world's economy. The sort of free trade fiasco I forgot to mention was that when China joined the World Trade Organization in 2001, the U.S. has seen, in the 10 years since, the U.S. has seen almost 3 million jobs lost due to direct trade with China,
nice.
Either offset by imports or countries moving, or companies moving their production overseas.
Mm-hmm.
So this thing is pretty scary.
Yes.
In terms of the scope.
Yes, it's been called NAFTA on steroids.
That's right. And it's not just...
It's going to make... I'd like to just briefly talk about the negative effects of these free trade.
Mm-hmm.
So one of them is loss of jobs.
Yep. Yep.
Salaries go down.
Mm-hmm.
For the workers.
Yep.
The money is shifted from the middle class up to the 1%.
That's exactly right. No, it definitely fuels rising inequality.
Yes.
You know, and the thing that, you know, the other caveat with free trade theory
yes.
is that it is free trade theory benefits the economy in aggregate in the long run. That means
yes.
if one billionaire makes an extra $1 billion and everyone else loses out, as long as $1 has been gained for the economy, that's a gain. you know? So really, it's just serving to concentrate wealth further at the top.
Further at the top and taking it away from everyone else.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So it's the free really applies to the CEOs of the corporations.
Yep. Right? Sure. Yeah.
The upper crust of the corporations, not the workers of the corporations.
That's
at
right.
All.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's right.
For the rest of us, it almost puts in slavery. I mean, you could almost say that though. It does.
It definitely has led to stagnating wages, to, you know, the gutting of middle class jobs. When corporations are free to move around the world to wherever the wages are the lowest and the regulations are the least, workers are definitely going to lose out.
Okay. So we have a clip from Chomsky.
Yeah.
Talking about TPP. Let's watch it.
Other big news in the U.S. these days is what we can glean about something called the Trans-Pacific Partnership. What can you tell us about this trade deal that's being described as NAFTA on steroids?
Well, actually, I can't tell you very much because it's being kept secret. Not entirely secret. Major corporations are part of the process. They know what's going on. The public is kept almost entirely out. Probably there's some selected elements of Congress that are allowed to know a bit. But it's essentially an executive agreement jointly with multinational corporations. We can imagine what it's like, and there's leaks here and there. It appears to be basically within the kind of framework of the World Trade Organization and NAFTA rules. These things are called free trade agreements. They're not. They're, for one thing, a lot of what they're involved with isn't even trade. It's just called trade to sneak it into these agreements. So a good deal of NAFTA and the World Trade Organization rules are investor rights provisions. That has nothing to do with trade. It's called, trade-related investment mechanisms or something. A lot of it is pure protectionism, very high protectionist elements. It obviously undermines free trade for the benefit of pharmaceutical corporations, Disney and others. It's just to try to protect their exorbitant profits.
It's an executive agreement with the president.
Mm-hmm.
And it's in secret.
Yep.
How are they able to get away with this?
Well, it's interesting. For all the advances in democracy that we've had, trade negotiations are still done through a process that's several thousand years old. It's diplomatic negotiations, right? The king appoints his diplomat or his ambassador to go off to the foreign nation, and they meet in an exotic location, and they come away with this agreement.
Yeah.
The way it works in the United States is that the United States Trade Representative, who right now is Michael Froman, who used to be a bigwig financial guy, is part of the executive office of the president. That means he's an ambassador. And it means, among other things, that he's able to keep the negotiations classified. So the president is charged with negotiating treaties in the Constitution. So the United States Trade Representative...
Classified.
That's right, classified. that means that you and I, the press, and even...
Congress.
Most of Congress is unable to see what's being proposed in our own name.
Yes.
However, there are also what are called cleared advisors. These are people who have essentially lobbied the executive branch to become advisors to the United States Trade Representative and see part of the classified negotiating text.
Are these the 600?
Yeah, for the Trans-Pacific Partnership, there's over 600 cleared advisors. Over 90% of them represent corporate and business interests.
And they're advising Congress?
They're advising USTR, so they have more access to the text than even Congress has.
Oh.
Yeah, so they, can at the click of a button log into the, the secure website and view the negotiating text and weigh in to the diplomats who are doing the negotiations.
And these 600 people are getting, advisors are getting paid by?
Well, they're, like I said, they're generally representatives of corporations, so
yes.
they're serving on the advisory council, but they're
yes.
largely, you know, corporate lobbyists, so they're on,
yes.
On the corporation payroll.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. So that's, you know, that's essentially the process. The public is kept exceedingly in the dark. And then, you know, you couple that with the fact that every major trade agreement that the United States has passed has been first preceded by something that's called fast track or trade promotion authority.
Right. Now this is the fast track is relatively new, isn't it?
Sort well, of? It started with Nixon.
It started with Nixon.
Richard Nixon, and essentially what they realized was that. When Congress realized how international competition was going to be hurting their districts, there's no way they would pass anything.
Yes.
So they went to Congress and said, in order for us to get the best deal possible from these countries, we need you to give us this authority to negotiate the agreements. And so Fast Track essentially does three things. It requires, instead of going through the normal treaty ratification process, they essentially designate the president as a agent of Congress, essentially giving up their constitutional power under Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution to regulate international commerce, and say to the president, you negotiate this agreement, and once it's done and you've signed it, we'll give you an up or down vote within 60 days in the House and then an additional 30 days in the Senate, and we won't make any amendments to it, and we'll limit the debate to 20 hours. So. If you think of something like the Affordable Care Act, which is going into, you know, effect
Limit the debate now. In Congress?
Yep, that's right.
To 20 hours?
That's right.
That's all they get?
That's right. So if you think about something like the Affordable Care Act, which is just going into effect now, people wailed and moaned that they had no time to read it and they were voting, you know, mm-hmm. and it was thousands of pages long, et cetera, et cetera. Regardless of the merits of those arguments, the TPP is going to be hundreds of thousands of pages long. Literally hundreds of times the length of the Affordable Care Act. And Congress is going to be expected to vote on it within 2 months of it being submitted.
With only that limited number of hours.
Yeah, with that limited number of hours of debate. That's what Fast Track does. And no major trade agreement has passed without it. There have been numerous other agreements that have passed that have been relatively minor that have passed without Fast Track. But the big ones, NAFTA, WTO, CAFTA, et cetera, have all had this mechanism in place where Congress essentially takes themselves out of the equation in terms of negotiating
yes.
these agreements, even though these international agreements override every single federal, state, and local law that
yeah.
we have on the books. You know, it's a real undermining of the democratic process. I think
yes.
maybe now would be a good time to play the Lori Wallach.
All right, let's do that.
Clip. I think
okay.
we might be a little bit ahead of schedule.
Yeah.
But,
all right, let's play the next clip.
But the summary of the entire history of trade authority of the United States is, for a very long time, Congress kept a really tight control over it. And then in 1974, just to skip 200 years, of Congress in charge, the executive branch doing what they said, Richard Nixon thought, this is an interesting opportunity to, shocking, grab some of Congress's power. And actually, not just over trade, but over the right to set our legislation. So this is what Fast Track does. In one lump sum, the executive branch simply, if Fast Track is ever in place, simply has to give notice 90 days before it intends to start a negotiation. The executive branch picks the country by themselves. Congress has no way to veto, no say on it. They set the content of the agreement and they negotiate the whole thing. They sign the agreement with the contents they've unilaterally determined before Congress votes. Then they are able to write legislation. Yes, the executive branch, not Congress, writing legislation. And Congress doesn't have any of the normal procedures. So it doesn't even go through the committees to get amended to what Congress likes. This is really written by the executive branch. It gets immediately dropped into the floor, into the hopper for a vote. In 60 days in the House, 30 extra days in the Senate, guaranteed vote. The White House takes over the floor schedule of the United States Congress, which for the constitutional scholars over there is not just an Article 1-8 problem, that is an Article 1-5 problem, which says that Congress, each session, each body sets its own rules and procedures. And then they guarantee no amendments, 20 hours of debate, yes or no vote on this thing that they never had anything to do about, never had any moment to have any content control over. So one sort of wiseacre calls fast track a legislative laxative that is bad for the U.S. Constitution. This is an accurate description, but it's also really bad for us. It's fast track that made possible some of the worst agreements we've ever gotten into. Since 74, we have had literally hundreds of trade agreements. Only 16 required fast track. That's NAFTA, that's WTO, that's CAFTA. The ones that are like skunks at the picnic that could not get through the Congress without some kind of legislative handcuffs are the ones that get fast track. So it's always a really good indication that something is rotten, rotten, rotten when the president says, I've got to have fast track to finish this agreement. So
it's just hard to take in.
Yeah.
It's like skipping the balance of powers, skipping the Congress altogether, and just having...
Absolutely. You know, it really, you know, does away with the separate branches of government, you know. And one thing, you know, that's worth mentioning is that, you know, the president actually is, you know, is granted authority in the Constitution to make treaties, right? Provided two-thirds of the majority of the Senate concur with the treaty. But these aren't actually treaties, even though in international law they're treated as treaties. In U.S. law, and Laurie alluded to it a little bit in the video, these are executive agreements.
Yes.
Where, when it comes to foreign policy, the president exercises his power to create the agreement and then can ask for congressional approval, actually, or not ask for congressional approval. The funny thing is there's...
Or not.
Yeah, there are types
They don't have to
There are some agreements, and they're generally peace treaties where when it comes to foreign affairs, the president can act or has acted unilaterally. Now, the funny thing is, though, is that there's nowhere in the Constitution that actually says the president has the authority to make these agreements. All it ever talks about is treaties, which require two-thirds majority. But when these types of agreements have been challenged in the courts have refused to rule on them, citing what's called the political question doctrine that says we're not going to rule on this because otherwise we might be usurping the power of the executive and legislative branch. So the court actually has kind of punted on it. They haven't actually ruled it constitutional or unconstitutional. But it's some very, very dubious playing with the Constitution that allows them to do fast track.
Yeah.
And because, like Laurie said, they're essentially granting to the executive branch five powers that are generally designated for Congress, including the ability to set their own congressional schedules, to write their own legislation, to approve treaties. You know, it really is pretty amazing the amount of power that we grant to one person.
Yes.
You know, and then the executive branch, their ambassadors, you know, through fast track legislation.
Wow. Oh, my gosh. And they're supposed to be the ones that write the laws, too.
Right.
I mean, that's what Congress is...
That's what we elect them to do, yeah.
But never mind.
Exactly.
They don't write them for these. Okay. So, I understand that TPT has 29 chapters.
Mm-hmm.
And although it is... trade, it says trade.
Mm-hmm.
It's only five of the 29 even have anything to do with trade at all.
That's right.
Okay.
You know, what they're talking about in the other chapters are what are called non-tariff barriers to trade.
Yeah.
So you've got your tariffs, which are taxes, right? We tax goods that are imported from other countries.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and this, it does two things. The reason historically that they've existed has been for two reasons.
Mm-hmm.
The first is a source of government revenue. Tariffs were actually the way our federal budget was funded for the most part up until World War I.
Oh.
Yeah. And tariffs actually used to be a big deal in every election cycle. When was the last time you heard about tariffs as a major issue in an election?
Hmm.
They funded the government, but they also allowed governments to decide, well, what are areas that we, you know, are critical to our economy that we want to make sure that we're investing in so that the quality of life of the citizens that are living in our communities around our countries aren't adversely impacted. And so that they could, enact tariffs on certain goods so that production in our country wouldn't suffer.
Exactly.
And we could, you know, we could we could manage the economy, essentially, so that there weren't vast swaths of unemployed people. But only five chapters deal with eliminating tariffs. So that's the big, you know, source of outsourcing, right? Is eliminating tariffs so that corporations can move and then you know, move their production overseas and sell the goods right back to the United States. The other side of this argument will tell you, oh, we have to open the markets because only 5% of the population lives in the United States. We have to find new people to sell to. Well, the fact of the matter is we're only 5% of the population, but we're 33% of the global consumer market. So everybody wants to sell stuff to us. We're the ones who are buying, even in the recession.
Even now, when we don't have any money to buy.
Really, when they're eliminating tariffs, they're not trying to access other markets. They're trying to access their production so that they can send it back to the United States without paying those tariffs.
Yes.
But like I said, that's only five chapters of the agreement. The other chapters deal with what are called non-tariff barriers to trade. Well, what you need to understand when you hear that term is that's essentially any law that a big corporation doesn't like. Anything that inhibits their ability to sell a product anywhere in the world, they can claim as a non-tariff barrier to trade and put it on the table for negotiation in the trade agreement. Done behind closed doors, written by corporate lobbyists. Just a few examples. In 2010, we passed the Dodd-Frank Act, which, you know, for what it was worth, limited the power of big banks. The big banks, I think people largely agree, were responsible for the economic downturn in 2008 and the recession. And those same big banks are now cleared advisors. Cleared advisors to the negotiations. You know, they've got their access to the TPP.
So among the people that can know what's going on, they're definitely a part of it.
Yep. So they're, from what we've heard, trying to overturn large parts of the Dodd-Frank bill through this trade negotiation. These are laws that we've passed in our country through the normal legislative process that the big banks don't like. So they're using an alternative lawmaking system to get, to put policies in the place they couldn't get through the normal legislative process. So banks are definitely a big thing. Big pharma's also at the table. When NAFTA was negotiated back in the early 90s, we were largely dealing with goods, right? I sold you corn, you sold me a tractor, and we had a trade. In CAFTA and in subsequent agreements, as technology has progressed, we've seen that just about anything that you can do as work can be, traded across borders. So legal services, healthcare, education, have all been part of subsequent agreements. And now in the Trans-Pacific Partnership, they're pushing what's called intellectual property agreements. Basically your ideas, right? Patents, copyrights, all of those things. So Big Pharma would really like to extend drug patents on their drugs so that it's harder to get generic drugs throughout all of the TPP negotiating countries. So this is clearly a case where this is the opposite of free trade. This is protectionism for the big corporations. But what does that mean in concrete terms? Well, if you live in Malaysia and you've got AIDS, currently you can get a generic set of treatments probably from India for about $75. Under the leaked text from the intellectual property chapter, and bear in mind, you know, the only things we know about the TPP are from leaked chapters.
Leaked chapters.
Like someone who's party to the negotiations who can see the text has leaked it to the media. So these are people who have literally committed treason in order to let we, the American people, know what our government is proposing in our name. But according to the leaked...
A whistleblower sort of fact.
That's exactly right. But according to that leaked chapter, that same set of generic AIDS treatments would go from $75 to $10,000 to $12,000. Yeah.
Well, who can afford that?
Right. No, we're literally talking about thousands of lives if that chapter gets actually passed in the law. It's pretty scary. Another, you know, real big area is, of course, you know, we talk about jobs leaving the country, but we don't, you know, talk a whole lot about, you know, the conditions where they're going.
Oh, exactly.
And, you know, and sweatshop labor is a big issue in the TPP, because one of the countries who's part of the agreement is Vietnam. Vietnam is commonly known as the low-cost labor alternative to China.
Yes.
The average daily wage is about $2.60 an hour. Yeah.
I heard it was $4 a day.
I'm sorry. That's you're right.
But it was $5 a day in China. Excuse
no,
it,
yeah, no, 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 no. I'm sorry.
$5 a day in China and $4 a day in Vietnam.
Well, it depends on where you go in Vietnam. I meant to say $2.60 a day in Vietnam.
There.
Yeah. Yep. And the reason I got it incorrect is because it's sort of ironic because after NAFTA, we saw a lot of jobs go to Mexico, where the average age wage was about $2.50 an hour.
Yes.
Now those same jobs that are in Mexico are now going to go across the Pacific Ocean to you know, Vietnam and Malaysia, where the average wage is about equivalent to the average hourly wage in Mexico. But it's not just the wages. You know, Vietnam has been cited numerous times for violating international human rights standards. They, you know, they have a very tightly controlled press. And frankly, a lot of
and
the
safety standards.
Exactly. A lot of the factories that where they're making things, especially clothing, are very similar to Bangladesh, where we saw the factory collapse and the thousands of workers died, and now they're protesting, you know, having global protests. I've had this explained to me, exactly what the factory conditions are like and why they're like that. So in Bangladesh, for example, and Bangladesh is actually thinking about joining the TPP, in Bangladesh, because of the way the inheritance laws work, you don't actually have to build a factory. If you have an apartment building and you sell it to your brother, you can convert it into a factory and you don't have to obey all of the safety standards that you would have to build, obey if you built a factory. So if you tour these things, there are kids sitting in the fire escape, sewing clothes, in all the hallways, you know, by the fire exits, you know, they're blocked. And so no wonder they're able to sell us really cheap T-shirts at Walmart. You know, I mean, these are the conditions that these people work in. So sweatshop labor is going to be a big deal in the TPP. Of course, you know, independent trade unions are completely illegal in Vietnam.
There's no way that rights can be enforced or that we can protect the rights of the workers
all? We would like to think that there's going to be strong labor provisions in the TPP and that there's going to be some enforceability. But frankly, you know, until we know what's in the text, you know, we're not going to know.
Really know.
All we know is we know what's going on now in Vietnam, which is not good. Yes. And we know the history of past free trade agreements, which has also been not good.
You know,
has been a perpetuation and in fact an acceleration of low wage sweatshop labor.
And the history of how much the corporations have cared about safety.
Right. No, that's exactly right. They'll do the PR campaign after the accident happens and say they're, you know, apologetic, and then they'll move to the next place where, you know, where the media is less likely to report on them.
Yeah.
Another really big thing in the Trans-Pacific Partnership is going to be food safety. Part of it would be banning labeling of food.
Yep.
Country of origin labeling, so that you don't know where your food was produced. Because corporations have argued that if you know where your food is coming from, you're less likely to buy it. If you know that it's coming from outside the United States, you're less likely to buy it. That, therefore, is a non-tariff barrier to trade. You know, they're literally saying that knowledge is a barrier to trade. They don't want you knowing stuff, because if you know stuff, you're less likely to buy their products.
Yeah.
Well,
so you know, with labeling,
that's not just, you know, that's just not undermining the government, that's undermining the market. The market, you know, an efficient market functions when people have good, you know,
information,
yeah. You know, so they're literally distorting the market but fish is a good example. you know, we talked about sweatshop labor in, mm-hmm. in Vietnam and South Asia. When you get to the fishing industry, we're literally talking about slave labor. In the open seas, there's no way to enforce labor standards on a fishing boat.
Yeah.
And the you know, the health inspections and regulations by which they abide is abysmally low. But then we, you know, in the negotiations, we pass what's called regulatory harmonization. It's you know, it's a very corporate sounding term, and essentially what it means is that we in the U.S. are going to treat food that was caught or grown in Vietnam as though it has been inspected in the United States.
Wow.
If it's been inspected there or Malaysia or, you know, Mexico or wherever, if it's inspected there, yeah. we will treat it as having been inspected here. And of course, you know, the USDA only inspects about 1% of food imports as it is.
Yes.
So, you know, if the TPP passes, we're going to see a big flood of, you know, very unsafe food products
oh.
in our stores.
How about the internet?
Well, you know, if you remember the Stop Online Piracy Act in 2011, this is also part of the intellectual property chapter that was leaked. What we saw is that the corporations who couldn't get that passed, that Stop Online Piracy Act, which would have done all sorts of things for being them being able to monitor your behavior on the internet and shut down websites that they didn't like.
Mm-hmm.
That same legislation was in actually a more severe form was in part of that leaked intellectual property chapter.
Oh.
So this could have, you know, very serious repercussions for your freedom on the internet.
Mm.
The other pillar I wanted to touch on was how it could affect what's called government procurement or the way we spend our tax money.
Right.
Essentially, what there's a chapter that says what states, what governments can use their tax money to buy, basically undermining our own sovereignty for how we spend our tax money. And not only saying, you know, what we can buy and what has to be opened up to private corporations to bid on, but the qualifications for that bid. So right now, if the state of Minnesota wants to do a highway project, for example,
okay,
they generally pass what's called a project labor agreement or a prevailing wage law, which says they're going to, you know, if a contractor wants to bid on the project, they have to agree to pay a certain standard of wages.
Right.
Under the Trans-Pacific Partnership or other agreements, that could be completely undermined. If we want to have a preference for products made in Minnesota, the TPP could make those preferences a violation of trade law because it unfairly discriminates against foreign corporations. So, you know, literally undermining our democracy, literally undermining our sovereignty. In previous trade agreements, state and local governments haven't been held subject to the procurement agreements.
Right.
But it's rumored that Canada is proposing that state and local governments actually be held to the procurement agreements. And actually, in the European agreement that's also being negotiated, which is a whole other show, they're thinking they want to try to open that up as well.
Okay, I want to ask something.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say a minimum wage law gets passed.
Mm-hmm.
Are you saying then that if TPP gets passed, that would have more to say about what people get paid than, I mean, it could override our national rules?
Yeah, potentially. I mean, if it were negotiated in the agreement, then yeah, absolutely. You know, to be perfectly honest, it's unlikely that a minimum wage law would be affected.
Yeah, yeah.
But it, you know, it definitely, you know, any state, federal, or local law that we've passed is subject to overturn through the Trans-Pacific
yes.
Partnership. You know, not all of them will be. Of
yeah.
course, the United States has, you know, some interest in protecting the laws of its citizens,
mm-hmm.
But. If you know, if we cave on the negotiations to any of these countries, and there's 12 countries who are all trying to get their own concessions from us, and we're of course trying to get concessions from them as well, if we cave on any of that, then all the laws that, you know, we caved on would be overturned.
Oh my God.
Yep.
Okay.
And then of course, you know, the last piece of this puzzle
yeah.
is perhaps the most ominous,
right.
which is called investor-state dispute settlements. So the corporations get all this stuff in the agreement, and if they think that a country has enacted a regulation that violates the agreement, they can sue them for the loss of future expected profits, the money that they think they're going to make down the road. They haven't made the money yet. They haven't lost the money. It's the money they think they're going to make in the future.
Oh.
And they do this not in the normal judicial system of any country, but they do it in an international trade tribunal. So a panel of lawyers actually decides the case. And they do so, and these lawyers, when they're not sitting on these panels, are generally corporate counsel. So now we've taken two of the three branches of government out of Congress. And I actually think this next clip is talks
okay,
more about
should
that.
Okay, should we play? Yeah, this is good. In Congress.
It has one chapter we know about, which is so egregious, that Australia has said they have to have a total exemption. And the U.S. has said, sure, okay, we understand you want to protect your people. We'll let you do that, but we don't want to protect ours. This is a little provision similar to NAFTA, which gives corporations the power to challenge in foreign tribunals, not U.S. courts, our domestic laws that protect consumers and the environment. We would now give this authority to corporations. If China accesses to this, that are run by the communist government of China, because they own many of the corporations in their country. The People's Liberation Army owns those corporations. This is extraordinary. 600 corporations have access to this document, but no member of Congress has access to this document. And yet, this is the trade future. This is a 21st century trade agreement, we're told by this administration. And further, chief negotiator for the United States has said it's his greatest desire that China become part of this, because then China would be bound by these rules. Oh yeah, I heard that before. We used to vote annually on China's trade performance, and we had a stick called most favored nation status. When we gave up that stick, I voted against it, we gave them permanent most favored nation status. Then they could join the World Trade Organization. But they said, don't worry, now they'll have to follow the rules. Guess what? They don't. And if they get in this agreement, they won't follow the rules either. Kiss our economy goodbye if the secret agreement goes through.
Well, not only our economy, but it globally.
Mm-hmm.
It destroys every country that's involved.
That's right.
Oh, the more I learn, the more it just gets worse.
Yeah, well, let me give you a couple of examples real quick of how this investor-state dispute settlement has played out in recent years. The most recent example is around fracking. There's a company called Lone Pine Resources that's based in the United States, and they're currently suing the government of Canada for Quebec's ban on fracking. And they're saying that banning fracking, not allowing us to come in and mine in your province, is a violation of NAFTA. And so they're suing them for, I believe, $300 million. It's a huge amount of money.
Because they don't want us to do fracking.
That's right.
In their country.
In their country.
On their land. And
yeah. And if this case is decided in favor of the corporation, and of course, Canada's going to have to spend millions of dollars to defend themselves in the NAFTA tribunal, on court costs and labor, lawyers'
fees
and whatever. If the corporation wins, that could have really serious implications for us here in Minnesota, because we don't do a lot of fracking here in Minnesota, but we do a heck of a lot of silica sand mining, which is used in that process. And there have been talks about putting in moratoriums on the sand mining. And of course, regardless of how someone feels about the mining, the fact that we could be opening ourselves up to a trade case where the state of Minnesota would, have to put up millions of bucks and the U.S. government would have to put up millions of bucks to defend a law that we passed here in our own state legislature to protect, our quality of life and our environment is absurd. Another example of the trade cases, the NAFTA tribunals.
Yeah.
Cargill, a company here in Minnesota, recently sued the government of Mexico and won $77 million over Mexico's attempt to regulate high fructose corn syrup. Sugar, right?
They want, Mexico wanted to regulate it within Mexico.
That's right.
For their Mexican citizens.
That's right. Mexico's been having a major public health crisis in the last 20 years.
Right.
You know, childhood obesity.
Yes. Following suit from the United States.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. Well, so basically, you know, when we exported all of this corn, much of it came across the border in the form of high fructose corn syrup and, of course, got put into all these sugary products that were marketed to kids. At the same time, you know, their nutrient-rich vegetables and fruits were being sold across the border in the United States where there's a higher profit margin on them. So you had this really big public health crisis in Mexico. So the Mexican government limited imports of high fructose corn syrup to try to curb their public health problem. Cargill sued them, and in the NAFTA tribunal was awarded $77 million. And of course, Mexico had to reverse the regulation as well.
Yes.
And Mexico has now overtaken, just in the last couple months, the United States as the most obese country in the world.
I've heard that.
Yeah.
I didn't realize exactly why, but that explains it.
Yep. The Mexican ambassador to the UN has blamed NAFTA for the obesity crisis in Mexico. And of course, if the Mexican government tries to do anything about the actual causes,
yes,
like we saw with the Cargill case, they're going to get sued.
Yes. So
it's really ominous, and it's it's scary.
Wow.
Yeah.
No wonder the Pope just came out and said something about money is the root of all evil.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, it just is following this. Okay, anything else we wanted to talk about with we pretty much covered.
Yeah, we did talk about immigration. I mean, you know, the thing to realize is that, you know, these corporations, of course, doing this behind closed doors, are trying to, you know, it's not about free trade, it's about protection for themselves.
Yeah.
So one thing that we've heard could happen.
It's about corporations being able to do whatever they want,
right,
regardless of the effects,
yep,
on the people, the health, the well-being of anything.
So free trade has, you know, this history of displacing people who then become economic immigrants. But not only is it going to displace people and create immigrants, what they're trying to do is create a two-tier system for citizenship as well, and visa status to enter, you know, the Trans-Pacific Partnership countries, including the U.S., so that if you've got an MBA, you can go to any of these countries, you know, just, you know, jet around and get an expedited visa. Well, of course, if you're a farmer who's been displaced by the trade policy and you want to try to find a job, you're screwed.
Yes, exactly. So,
you know, the way it favors the rich over everybody else is just, you're pretty stunning.
Right. And yet, well, anyway, there's so many people that think that free trade is a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
They just don't understand it.
Right.
That has to be it.
Yep.
Because all of this really seems like an assault, mm-hmm, on democracy, which is one of the things you talked about before the show.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just killing
the
people from having any say in what happens.
That's right. No, we're using an imperialist negotiation process where the big corporations are writing the laws behind closed doors.
Right.
And further concentrating their power and really undermining the ability of us as local communities to have a say about our own quality of life. You know, we're really shifting from a democracy to a corporatocracy. Right? Because when these corporations control so many aspects of your life, they're essentially functioning like a government. You know, it's corporate government. It's a huge assault on democracy. It really undermines our ability to pass laws to protect our own quality of life. Mm. And of course, you know, with the fast track process in place, that's going to expedite the process.
Yes.
You know,
and
we've got a really big challenge ahead of us.
Mm-hmm.
So what we've been doing with the Minnesota Fair Trade Coalition is really working to shed the light on the TPP. So I've been doing programs like this, as you mentioned. I do about 50 presentations a year to get the word out on the TPP and on Fast Track. Fast Track, I mean, there's good news here. There is some good news. The good news...
Let's hear some good news.
The good news is that one of the major speculations that they're even doing the TPP to begin with is that we've essentially won on major trade agreements for the last 10 years. You know, CAFTA
doesn't feel like that.
CAFTA passed in 2005, and that was fairly large, but still relatively small. Central American country economies are not that big.
Okay.
You know, devastating for the people who are affected, of course. Ever since 1999, with the battle in Seattle, which really shut down the World Trade Organization ministerial, there's been no major expansion of the World Trade Organization. We've pretty much successfully shut down those talks. When they tried to pass the Free Trade Area of the Americas in 2001, we launched mass mobilization, and we were able to beat that back.
Was that the one in Miami?
Yeah, that was Miami, yeah. So the good news is that we could win on this stuff. And not only can we win, but we can stall these agreements from ever coming to a vote if we can beat fast-track legislation. Fast-track legislation was supposed
to... should be illegal.
We
shouldn't have it. It's...
I think that's...
It's not what the Constitution says, and it's... Yes,
right, no, there's a very strong argument for that, absolutely.
Yes.
The last time fast-track passed, it passed for 5 years. And it covered all the agreements that were negotiated within those 5 years. It passed in 2002 by 3 votes at midnight, right before the August recess. And it expired in 2007. So it's a controversial policy. You know, not only is the public outraged when they find out that Congress is giving up its authority, but a lot of members of Congress don't actually want to give up that authority. You know, our members of Congress...
Yeah, I hope not.
Our members of Congress here in the Twin Cities, Keith Ellison and Betty McCollum, are both very strong advocates for maintaining congressional authority over trade, which is good.
Good.
Yeah. But the Obama administration has asked for fast-track authority, again, for the Trans-Pacific Partnership. They wanted a bill to pass over the summer. We've stalled them on that. They're trying to get something passed by the end of the year. We're trying to stall them out on that. But essentially, if we can beat Fast Track, if we can win that vote in Congress, then the Trans-Pacific Partnership is, one, either going to stall out, or two, they're going to submit it to Congress, and Congress is going to make all sorts of amendments, and it's either going to look really good, or it's going to be in a form that'll never pass Congress.
Yes.
You know, because every member of Congress is going to want to carve out for their district to protect their industries, to protect the constituents that they were hired to represent. And then, of course, the other countries would have to go back. So the process would be so convoluted at that point that it would never get passed. My personal opinion is that if it's that unpopular, it shouldn't get passed.
Exactly.
Which, of course, you know, when the public, when the public knows about trade agreements, they're wildly opposed to them. Almost 70% of people
when
think
they really
NAFTA was
understand the nitty-gritty of it.
That's absolutely right. Yep. And so we've been doing public education for about the last year and a half on the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Really making sure that people understand and then mobilizing people to call their members of Congress.
Yes.
We really need people to be contacting both senators from Minnesota, Al Franken and Amy Klobuchar, and telling them that they need to oppose Fast Track. We really think that, you know, we can do trade right. We can have a robust system of importing and exporting that creates a race to the top instead of a race to the bottom.
Yes.
You know, we actually export more to countries that we don't have free trade agreements with than countries we do have them with. These agreements aren't really about increasing exports. They're not about increasing jobs. They're not about increasing market access. They're not about increasing trade. They're about corporate deregulation.
Yes.
And we need to make sure that our members of Congress and our senators are fully aware that that's the case.
And global corporate deregulation.
That's right.
All over.
That's exactly right. Yep. They're using the negotiations to usurp our normal domestic lawmaking process.
Yes.
And I think, you know, so members of Congress not only need to stand up for us, but they need to stand up for themselves and for their, you know, for the jobs. They need not to outsource their own jobs to the president.
Exactly.
I would ask everyone who's watching to stay tuned, because a fast track vote could be coming up anytime this fall.
Oh, my God.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, they've stated that they actually want to conclude the Trans-Pacific Partnership negotiations by the end of the year. It's kind of iffy whether or not they'll actually be able to do that.
Because I understand they've been making it, or it's been in process for almost four years.
Yeah, that's right, since 2009.
And now they're thinking this fall?
Yeah.
They could vote on it?
They'll vote on fast track this fall.
They'll vote on fast track.
Yeah, had wanted to vote on the Trans-Pacific Partnership this fall, but they're not getting the negotiations done in time. We've been able, I think, to stall them out, us in the global trade movement. We work with other trade coalitions in other states, and we work with partners globally as well to mount opposition and really try to shed the light on these very secret
agreements.
So when
we contact our congressmen, we want to tell them they're going to vote on fast track, right? And we tell them to say, no way.
That's right.
We want it gone.
That's right. Stand up for democracy.
Yep.
Stand up for us as your constituents and vote no on fast track.
Right, right. Okay. I wonder sometimes if so many people don't understand when they hear the thing, trade agreement, or how much effect it really has on all of our lives.
No, that's right. And that's why it's so important that we understand what's in them. Because free trade agreements are the exact same progressive fights that we have at the state and local level every day.
Yes.
It's just a different arena, and it's an arena in which the deck is stacked much more favorably towards the largest corporations in the world.
Yes.
So it's really important to be paying attention to them. I would urge people to get in touch with the Minnesota Fair Trade Coalition, us on Facebook.
Okay, do we have a website for that?
Yep, our website is www.mnfairtradecoalition.org.
Okay.
You can find us on Facebook, you can find us on Twitter. We have an email list. We keep people up to date pretty constantly.
Good.
There's lots of opportunities to get mobilized to advocate for trade policy that affects, that is to the benefit of working families here in the United States and promotes human rights around the world.
Okay. So this vote on the fast tracking affects every aspect of our lives, affects every issue that people are involved in.
Yep. That's right.
If we're going to call in and ask our Congress how to vote on this one issue, it could help many, many issues.
That's right. Whether it's affordable housing or food or good government or whatever, this is going to have an effect on it.
Thank you so much for coming on tonight and telling us about TPT.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. Thanks for tuning in. Catch us on live, ourworldtodaytv.org.